human computer interaction and has been organizing workshop, conferences, symposia in the area of artificial and natural intelligence for almost 3 decades. Currently, he is a guest associate editor of research topic cognitive computation from neuronal circuit to social brain in a reputed journal of frontier in computational neuroscience. The area of his research interests include artificial and natural intelligence, fuzzy set, cognitive modeling, brain simulation, emotion, affect analysis, computer vision, and image interpretation, natural language processing, etc. He has played a leading role in investigating emotional model using EEG signal. He has also published in area of Indian language processing and psychological analysis of native Indian language speaker. He has published more than 80 technical papers in journal and proceeding, and authored and edited more than 10 books, including conference proceedings by Springer, IGI Global, Oxford University Press. He is fellow of IETE, senior member of IEEE and CSI. So from this small introduction, I am handing dais to Professor U.S. Tiwari, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So let me first assume some of the things that many of the faculty members who are attending this class or this lecture, I will say discussion, are teachers, maybe as engineers or mathematicians, I don't know. It's a mix of two, may I know it? Are there mathematicians also listening to our lecture?
Yes, dear participant, you can unmute yourself if you want to speak.
The PhD student also there.
Okay, that's great. So let me not take much time. So first of all, let me thank Professor Anupam and other organizers for inviting me here. Initially, I was, avoiding this lecture. Last 1 year, I am almost more than 12 lectures I have given, and I am a bit, tired of giving such lectures. So that's why I was thinking that, okay, can I avoid this? But anyway, thanks to Professor Anupam or Dr. Anupam, he insisted on giving some talk. So let me first say that I am basically an engineer. I am learning a lot of things, and because I am doing research in a multidisciplinary area, so I am always afraid of speaking with true mathematicians, psychologists, brain scientists, neurosurgeons, linguists, etc., although I work in all those areas and have to use their knowledge in the system. So therefore, again, to all of you, I will just do some discussion. Don't ask me many of the mathematical theorems involved into this, but I will try. You must raise questions, and I will try my best to discuss with you the topics. So let me first come to the first slide. So this is my talk. My talk today will be which is called as Explainable AI. And then I will talk to about interval type 2 fuzzy sets. And these two terms are very much related. So my purpose is neither to explain explainable AI nor the interval type 2 fuzzy sets, but try to see the link between the two. So my talk will be more on the how this interval type 2 fuzzy sets or type 2 fuzzy sets in general can be combined with, can be linked with the kind of machine learning algorithms these days people are trying to find out new applications. So in those new applications, and especially for making it explainable, how type 2 fuzzy sets will work. So that is my goal for this discussion. However, if you have any question or anything, you can just raise your hand and ask question. No problem. So let me talk about one by one. So what I will do here in this talk in the next around 100 minutes, and then last 20 minutes, I hope there will be some discussion. So for the next 100 minutes, we will talk about what is explainable AI and why it has the need for explainable AI has come. So we will talk in more details about that. And then the main topic today is, that is the type 2 fuzzy sets. I will try to talk about a bit about that, you know, how it is different from the type 1 fuzzy sets. And then, of course, we are taking a very small subset of type 2 fuzzy sets. Although we have tried to work on the Gaussian type 2 fuzzy sets, but still we are only talking of the interval type 2 fuzzy sets. So then we will talk about interval type 2 fuzzy sets, and then how to apply them for the inferencing system for the multitask. Basically, we are working on the dialogue systems, so which is a natural language sentence. So we derive information out of the natural language, and then also the output of the system is also in natural language. So we work in type 2 fuzzy sets with the linguistic variables. And then a small bit of computing with word CWW, which is called by Mendel as perceptual computing, and he has given the framework. In my whole talk, I have given a lot of references of Mendel's, 7, 8 to 10 references, mainly by Mendel. So he has worked a lot on this, either type 2 fuzzy sets or the word given by computing with words was a very important one. So I will talk that framework, computing with words, a bit about that. And then, of course, my experiment, basically, we have one paper, basically on Hindi dialogues. And that paper is about just, so you have a digital assistant, like, you know, Google Assistant you have or some other assistant. So you ask question that book me a restaurant. So a restaurant I want, maybe in civil lines, maybe I must be there in half an hour. So please suggest me some hotel about that or some restaurant about that. So that kind of talk one can give. And based on that, suggestions will be given by the assistant, digital assistant. So we are calling this as SILPA assistant. We have a SILP lab, a speech, image and language processing lab. And that assistant is called SILPA, that is the SILP assistant. So it is basically a dialogue system, but it is, we call this as task-oriented dialogue systems. There are some open dialogue systems which are very difficult to handle. So we will not talk about that. So we'll explain you about that. What is our problem, how we define the linguistic variables, why it becomes a type 2 fuzzy sets, and then doing some experiment and getting the suggestion from that. So this is the four basically topics, subtopics I have included in this discussion. First is that we will talk about why explainable AI, the need for explainable AI. The second is interval type 2 fuzzy sets. Third is computing with words, and fourth is the dialogue systems solution. So these four parts I will talk into one by one details. So I started talking about, you know, soft computing in 1990. So I started my career as a teacher in 1988, so the first new thing which we introduced is which we called as expert systems. So while teaching AI, people will invariably start talking about expert systems. And still today, I have found out, you know, many of the people have given talk on control systems. Use of fuzzy logic in control systems is like, you know, almost one-to-one matching. You talk about control systems and you talk about fuzzy logic. What I am more worried about is that still today, even people stop at that point that people only talk about the control systems. I'm not saying that control systems should not be in control system. We should not use fuzzy logic, type 2, type 1, or even for higher order fuzzy systems. But we have to go beyond that. You know, you have to go beyond that. And the world has gone beyond that. In AI nowadays, expert systems are no longer in use in that sense. You know, so what we have come to that expert systems, what required is that you require a knowledge, basically a rule base from the experts. And which was very difficult to create. I mean, even if you are a very good expert, if you say that to a doctor, that please give you in rule base that all the types of diseases which can be diagnosed and give a symptoms based on that, it is not a, I mean, one cannot write it like this. You know, so many papers have been written to find out, even simply recognizing corona, the new version Omicron, people do not know exactly what they have to match. So they have got some proteins and et cetera, et cetera. So that way, it is not so, I mean, the rule base is not so linearly organized, cannot be linearly organized, because we have a complex systems. And therefore, the expert systems, when you start making it large, large expert systems, putting it more number of variables, changing the context or environment, the whole expert systems failed. You go on increasing the rule base. So we have one something called as the SOAR is a language, which is on which you create some of the expert systems. So NLP SOAR is a big system where they have put 8,000 rules, more than 8K rules into the system, and try to solve the natural language processing problems. They failed after that. However, they say that they have come to a particular types of translations through machine learning, through expert rule-based translation systems, but it has failed. It has failed. All the new ones, new translations, the Google, which is doing at present the translation from English to Hindi, let us say, these are based on what they call it as the neural translation. So neural translation is not a machine translation, which is a rule-based, but it is a neural network based, convolutional neural network people are using. So these types of things, so people change from the expert systems towards more adjustable systems, and more learning systems has come into existence. So we have now more learning systems. What the learning systems does is that the human being, instead of telling them the rules, the learning system will themselves create rules from the data. Like a human brain, so people have tried to model the human brain, which we are studying in the cognitive architecture or cognitive things. So based on that, they take directly from the data, they learn what knowledge they have to apply. So learn something from out of the given data, and then learn about how to solve the problem, and then start solving the problem. So that is the machine learning phase has come. And therefore, from the top-down approach, expert system is a top-down approach. They have come to bottom-up approach, where they said that, okay, the human being, first of all, they may not make rules. After that, they started creating some, features, what we call as. So human being manually created features, which we call as a knowledge problem representation. So features will be there, and then the features will be recognized, and based on that, some mapping will be done, and then some output will be found out, or the behavior will be followed, etc., etc. So that kind of they came to the feature level. Even that, people tried to make it automatic. So from data to feature selection, that was done manually, and then after that, it was the machine learning which was doing basically classification, optimization work, so that you can get the output. So this part was automatic, but then people said that, okay, even the feature finding can be done by the computers, by the systems. So the learning systems may not require any representation, directly give the data to the system. So that is how the machine learning nowadays people have now big data, a lot of data is there. You give directly data to that, and then it starts representing the problem on its own. The theorem is that if you give large amount of data, then it is possible to learn that. However, it gave problems. It has large amount of problems. Number one, that when you collect data, the data is not, I mean, the large amount of data, say for example, simply if you take image processing, or let us say human face, or any if you follow any vehicle tracking. So vehicle tracking systems. Now, if you see in the different conditions, so one condition in India and Allahabad, other condition maybe in Jaipur, the other condition may be in Bombay. Now, if you give the data of Bombay and try to, and the machine turns, tries to learn it, and then apply those rules in, let us say, Bangalore, you will find it can substantially fail. So it is, one can assume that all the rules are, you know, or whatever the machine has learned, are context independent, but no problem is context independent. Now, if you want to keep the same context, then you will be repeating the things. There cannot be same context. So while collecting the data, you have certain conditions. You collect from one place, you collect in, let us say, day. And if you want to apply it at night, now that night may be a different one. Now you can say, okay, we will collect the data also in night. But now think about, you know, in December night, 10 o'clock, and in June night, 10 o'clock. Will that traffic will be same? Will the number of vehicles on the road will be same? No, it is not. Or there is a mela nearby, or there is a wedding party, etc., etc. So there are so much variations. So the whole problem, if you take at a mega level, you know, so want to know the traffic rules, learn the traffic rules from the traffic flow of India. So first of all, there can be questions of, can there be one such model which governs all over India? No, it is not. That's why the expert system failed. But then how the machine will learn? Okay, you can say that it will learn many of the things, and the specific things will be done by those systems. So the many of the transfer learning thing came into existence. To make it very short, I will say that the machine learning approach, which says that we will gather data and then learn the rules and apply that, has failed nowadays. It has some success, but it found that as soon as the context change, the whole system fails, you know. The problem is not that system fails. The problem is that one does not know when it is succeeded and when it has failed. This is the main problem of machine learning models, which we call as a black box model, you know. So machine learning things are working always, and now you have applied it onto, let us say, an aeroplane. And you know that Max aeroplane, Boeing design has failed because of the software failure. So software learns everything, and at crucial time it fails, and nobody is knowing that it is failing. There is a famous, you know, joke which says that for any question you ask, I can give you the answer 42. So the answer 42, now you cannot prove it is wrong. No one can prove it is right. But because a machine learning method has said number 42, you assume that it is right, and no one can prove it is wrong. So this is absurd. So the black box model, machine learning models, are something like which gives an answer. Now one does not know that it is correct answer or not correct answer. One does not know that this machine has been trained for Allahabad or not. Rather, it is not. Now I suppose I buy a software which has been created at California, some city, let us say Los Angeles, and then we are using it in Allahabad. Initially, of course, for 1-2 days it will do some kind of adaptation to Allahabad, but in 1-2 days how can you do the whole adaptation? So that kind of machine learning algorithms export to any other domain at any other place in any conditions has totally failed. So what does it do? It means that is, people are not thinking about that to give a some kind of reasoning, you know. So machine learning can be a kind of guess, a kind of heuristic. Now this heuristic is correct or not correct. So empirical data. So one can see that, okay, something has happened and something has happened. Suppose if there is a smoke somewhere, and then you think that there is a fire. Now this is a kind of empirical data. Now if the smoke gives rise to fire, so there must be a fire. For that we require some reasoning, some kind of explanation. If explanation is given correctly, then this is sure that if there is a smoke, there must be some kind of fire. So the main thing in science is not about empirical data. It is the first stage. The second stage is the through reasoning, you give an explanation. So giving explanation is one of the important factor of this one. That's why people have started talking about the explainable AI. I will talk about it afterwards. So that is the main thing one has to recognize. From expert systems, we have traveled up to learned systems, and I am calling it as automatically learned systems in the way the machine learning has been used up till now as a black box model. So give data to machine learning, it can learn anything and you can apply it anywhere. This kind of approach has completely failed, and now people are coming up many new kinds of architectures and the things, ways of handling the data. So these are the challenges of data-driven learnable systems, and for that the answer is what is people are calling as explainable and interpretable AI. If anyone has any confusion, you can just ask. Anyone? So the second part now, yeah. Someone was speaking? Okay, so please answer me sometimes, otherwise I will feel that, you know, I'm not connected.
No, sir, it's fine.
Okay, good. Yeah, so therefore, what we have come to know is that why we require an explainable AI. There is another angle to it, you know. So a machine learning thing, I say that, you know, if you always start, or I say that if you always begin from the beginning, when you will reach a large distance. So I say in Allahabad, so if I want to go to, let us say Sangam, and then I can walk only up to civil lines, half distance of that. And therefore, one day I get tired and then come back. And again, second day I start from here again and then reach up to the civil lines and again get tired. So if we go on continuing like this, we will never reach Sangam. So a machine learning thing, which learns from the beginning, from the data, comes up to a point. And then the next time, when you have more data or more things or new conditions, you again start from the beginning. So you will never reach a place which is long ahead. So you should not always begin from the beginning, you know. So, and that is how the world has progressed. What we have learned one century ago, we do not repeat that again today and then again start from the beginning. So we write books and all of you are studying, and therefore, you know, whatever has been done in one century, people get in 1 year, the whole knowledge if they want. People can get in 1 year, and then they proceed ahead. So the language, the knowledge we learn has to be transferred in the form of knowledge to the others, so that one has to not learn the same thing again. So you should not begin from the beginning. And that way this machine learning algorithms have to completely failed. You know, so one system learns and the second system has to again start from the beginning and learn. It cannot transfer whatever it has learned to the one. Whatever I have learned in my life, I am, you know, transferring to you in some way. I am communicating with you, and therefore you will not do the same thing again and again what I have done in my life, and then you have to start ahead of it. So going ahead requires that knowledge must be transferred and should be learned in more abstract form directly, rather than doing the same experiment and learning. If everybody starts burning their hand and learns that the fire burns a hand, then this knowledge is of no use. I mean, there is no knowledge as such. So that's what is the problem of the machine learning. If you start doing the explanation, or the now people are talking of the interpretable AI. So if you know the interpretation, then it is possible to know why this has been learned. And therefore, this knowledge can be transferred to the others. And not it is large number of architectures on transfer learning, etc., etc. I'm not going into details of that. So you have a pre-trained network, and then onto that you superimpose other amount of knowledge so that you can train it for in less amount of data, etc., etc. There are a lot of questions and a lot of problems and a lot of complexities involved into that. But that is the first thing, that the two problems. One is that this AI is a different context, gives you different kind of can give you different result. You do not know this result is correct or not. But the second problem, which is the transferability of knowledge, is not there, which requires this AI, which requires that this kind of interpretable AI should be done. So transferability of knowledge will require an explanation. An explanation, if it is done mathematically or in word language, natural language, then this is completely transferable. That's why the need for CWW, computing in words, has come. So computer works on these numbers, and the computer words works on numbers, but the knowledge is there in terms of the language. So the sentence is written on the, you can see here in this presentation. So explainable artificial intelligence, these three words convey many of the meanings. So these are words. Now, can this be handled by the computers? So computers is supposed to be a number crunching world, although we talk about classes, the name of the classes and the knowledge attached to those classes, etc., etc., and people have started working on to that. We have a framework which we call as the fuzzy systems. These fuzzy systems can convert the language or the linguistic variables for the time being, let us assume, into the numbers. So we require what we call
BRI.
Please mute your what I was saying is that you require a system, and fuzzy system is very important to that, that from the linguistic variable, that is the word, if I call this a language word, you can change them into numbers, and then you apply mathematics onto that, inferencing, fuzzy rules, fuzzy mapping, etc., etc., or just to apply an equation and find out the values. So those things you can get the output in numbers, and you can do a defuzzification. You can get back the words. So there is an approach of from words to numbers, apply the system. System does some computation, and then from numbers to words, this conversion can take place. And this conversion from words to this can be done automatically by the system. So what the user will see is that I am giving input in words and getting output in words. So that is called as computing with words. And that is what it is called also as the perceptual computing. And that framework has been given by Mendel, and we will talk a bit about that. So that is what is the link of explainable AI with the fuzzy systems. Explanations are generally there in especially in linguistic variables, and then in general words, I will say that any word can become a variable, except the names which are we call as the proper nouns. So proper nouns are basically constants, and as soon as you make it class name, so there are many instances of that. So there are many element. So you can think about a set name as a class name. So the cats is a class of animals, and that is a set you can create. So there can be some many class of animals, or rather four-footed animals can be one class. So that in that sense, it becomes a variable. So any word which is a common noun can become a variable, common noun, abstract noun, etc., etc. So in that sense, and verbs, especially the words which are verbs, actions, they are very complex words, which can be decomposed into many words, and then it gives rise to many kind of axons. So it can be again decomposed into whole sentences for this one. So in that sense, it is also a variable. So in that sense, you can think about that it is not simply very, very much, low, high, extreme, nearly, about to, nearly equal to, approximately. Only these are the linguistic variables, although by convention, generally, we talk about these as the linguistic variables. But linguistic variables can be any word in that sense, especially those nouns and accent verbs. These can be linguistic variables itself. And in that sense, we can do all the computing into that. So there are some methods about that. At present, I'm not going into details of all those things. But think about, especially for the time being, that this number, these linguistic variables, which are there in the language, those are given into numbers, and numbers are again converted back to words. That is very important. You know, we should take a very large database. Now, how can I see the large database? Suppose you have a network in Korea. There are more than 10 million, CCTVs all on the highways. Now, if there is one control room where there are, let us say, 100 people are there who are constantly seeing those CCTVs. Now, what they will come up with? So if there are 100 people and everyone seeing the 100 CCTVs together at the same time, first of all, they will be very tired of. So within hours, their mind will be tired. There is a lot of cognitive load onto those people. And even if some incident happens after when they get tired, it is very difficult to find it out that something has happened in real time, to find it out and then do something. So what do you require? You require that the system, human being, cannot understand numbers. Now, if I give a two-dimensional array with the values, then you cannot say it is face. If I say that pixel values is 25, 300, or not 300, 200, 201, 95, 0, 16. Now, what is this pixel value creates? You do not know. You can see a picture. You do not bother about pixel values. But a system, computational system, only understand those numbers. Those numbers represent something. So the computer system should tell us what is that representing. What is that thing, which we call as the data summarization. So large databases are there. The computational system should come up with summary of the data. And how this is summary of data? That, okay, this year, so many people have traveled with, let us say this Air India. There is a drop in the total number of people. There is a significant drop in the total number of travelers in the month of, let us say, some July. These sentences should be spoken by the system. It is not the human being has to see all the data, the whole table, three-dimensional, four-dimensional table of consisting of so many large number of data bytes, and then we'll find out, okay, this number has decreased or this number has increased. This kind of analysis should be done by the system itself, and therefore this is called as the data summarization, and fuzzy logic is very much used in data summarization. So this kind of word-based approach, the output should be in words, because human being can consume words very easily. They can understand those words, and it is a work burden of the system to convert numbers into the words, and vice versa, convert words into numbers for their convenience. So that is what is the CWW, which is being called. I will talk about CWW a bit more afterwards, but this is the scenario of explainable AI. As you can see here, this is from the artificial intelligence, explainable artificial intelligence, in the magazine, IEEE Computational Intelligence magazine, which is in February 2019. So what it talks about, as you can see here on the bottom, there is a fuzzy systems, and it is not talking of type 1 or type 2 or something like that. You can be anyone. And what it says is that so the numeric data is coming from here input and going to the here fuzzification process. So this numbers goes to fuzzification process. So you convert them into some kind of fuzzy rule system. So you give a fuzzy membership. And fuzzy membership of what? So low, high, very high, something like that, low, medium, high, or very low, low, medium, and high, and very high, something like that. So 5, 7, or 9, or whatever you like, that many number of rules you create, and based on that, it will associate with that variable, and then you apply an inference system here. This inference systems basically applies fuzzy rules. And fuzzy rules are simply mapping. We will talk a bit about that. So you apply here in the fuzzy rules, the output is a fuzzy set, and then this fuzzy set can be converted back to numbers. So this fuzzy inference system, where earlier expert systems, the experts has to feed rules manually, it is another machine can feed rules based on, you have so many things, you have fuzzy sets, you have rule base, you have database, you have rule base, and you have knowledge base. So all these bases are available in different forms. So you may have a database, you may have an ontology, you may have some other class information, you may have many other rules already created by someone else. Some people, human being, can create some rules. So all these things are available. Of course, it is just shown here in the diagram. The actual details of how it will be done, it requires many of the technological challenges to be handled. But based on that, if it interacts with that, this inference systems. So this is a kind of synergy between the existing knowledge or learning systems and the fuzzy inference systems. So that is how it is converted into explainable artificial intelligence. This is the part of artificial intelligence. It has to create something in some way, some representation, so that it can interact with the computational representations of the expert systems. So that is what this article said. The another one is that, you know, trying to combine the fuzzy logic with the evolutionary systems. Neural network does an emergence process, which is not an evolution, you know, it is an emergence. There is a difference between emergence and evolution. So the evolving network has to do some mutations, etc., etc. That kind of mutation is not there in this. So exploratory things can be done through the, which we call as the genetic algorithm. So earlier, when we teach soft computing, even today when we teach soft computing, so it has all these neural network, fuzzy logic, as well as genetic algorithm. These three, and then you can apply some more statistical methods, something like PSA, PSO, and other kind of optimization techniques. So all these together forms the soft computing. We are saying that the same soft computing framework can be done here. Only thing is that you do not create a specific neural network for one application and for other application. We try to use a generalized architecture, like, you know, convolutional neural network, or nowadays people are talking of LSTM, which is attention-based method, and many more new things. But that, together with the fuzzy logic and evolutionary system or GA, can create another framework for explainable AI. More details can be talked up afterwards. At present, let me go ahead. If anyone has any question, please ask. Well, so that's why what we are saying is that we have now considered two parts as such, not two parts, one part as such, that we require in machine learning explainable AI systems. Fuzzy logic is one important technique or method or model which can be used to do the, to create explainable AI systems. These things we have tried to understand, to discuss. Now let me get in a bit introduction about the type 1 fuzzy sets and type 2 fuzzy sets. I have seen the program, and large number of people have already talked about it. So I will not go into the details of that. I hope you know about what is linguistic variables and how to do fuzzification and how to talk about medium fuzzy functions. So you can have trapezoidal, you can have many exponential rules, bell-shaped rules, and many more rules. Many new rules have come. Only I will emphasize one more very important thing which you must understand. And that is, you know, we talk about rules and then we apply it. And we think that, you know, any number of rules or any type of rules we create. So someone says, many of the students will always ask me, sir, why not, you know, triangular rules? I will say that no triangular rules, you know, have no, I mean, this flat region at the top is not there. You have many, many elements in the set for which are good for the particular thing, and all of them has the membership value 1. So there is a flat region at the top, and which can come through simply trapezoidal rules. But then the people will ask that, okay, now so why not trapezoidal rules? Of course, one can use always trapezoidal rules, but the question is that any mathematical equations will fail at these corners. So you try to avoid those corners, because if you go from this side and if you come from this side, you know, there cannot be one smooth transition from one state to the other state. So you always require to smooth here to make the things continuity, and you smooth here, and similarly you can smooth here. So that way you can create an S type of rule when only it is increasing, and then you can have Z type of rules when it is decreasing. So create X and Z type of rules, it will become smooth. Of course, you can take a small part of that as a linear region, and that you can always, the angle for that derivation of that, you can always put them. So the different kinds of S and Z functions has been combined, or you can combine them together, make it symmetrical, make it exponential rule, etc., etc. Bell-shaped rule, these are the general rules there. One has to always do some experiment onto that. And what we have done in type 2 is also that, you know, the main problem in engineering problem solving is not that you apply any rule. The question is that you have to collect some input and output, do some experiment, you have to create the space of that, you know, the problem space, which I call it. So the fuzzy set is a subset. And where are the elements? What are the elements of fuzzy set? Almost all those elements which are in the universal set. So you have to define a membership value of universal set. Of course, you can take a alpha cut and say that any element which has membership value less than, let us say, 0.2 will not be considered as part of this one. That's fine. You can always create that. But the total number of elements into this subset is not known, because this is already a subset. And even the total, what is the universal set in question in the problem, that also you do not know. So you do not know, you don't have the complete information of all the values, all the possible values of X. If it would have been so, you know, the applying probability theory would have been better. And that's what I always say, that probability theory does not give you the space to experiment, does not give you, it has to be completely, you have to know all the possible cases. At least you must know the number of possible cases. Without that, you cannot proceed ahead. In cases where the total number of possible things are not known, you are generating them, you are collecting them through experiments. Then during the experiment, what you do, apply? Fuzzy is a rule. Fuzzy set is a mechanism which will allow you to do both the things, you know, create the universal set and then get the membership value, because you have some subjective parameters. You can apply some heuristics, you can apply some guessings. Of course, this heuristic is too far from the real solution, then anything you will do is completely wrong. So do some experiment, try to see that what kind of rules and what kind of space, the complexity of the problem space, what it comes out, what are the factors, how many factors are there, how do we partition it, in how many number of fuzzy values, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10, etc., etc. Is it multidimensional or a type 2? What is there? All these things can be understood first before applying any rule at anything. That is what is more important. That's what I wanted to emphasize. So when you, so what is important in this one is not the rule. It is a question of, it is a method of generalization. And what is that? And this is the, we call it as the extension principle. So a mapping in a normal case set can be extended in the case of fuzzy sets, what we call as the generalization of that function f, mapping function f. So what you have to do is that this mapping converts to finding out the applying, let us say, the max operation. So if you get, if from x to y you mapping with a function, let us say something like f. So fuzzy set is A and then B. So the membership value of B can be found out that whatever mapping from A to B possible, there can be multiple paths. Out of that, what is the max value of mu A? So mu B can be found out by taking, let us say, a max value, max operator. We can have a different operator, but let us say that there is one max operator. There are some product operator and other things people have talked about. It is a combination of product and sum, etc., etc., and so on. So therefore, there is one operator. There is one. What there can be a method of generalizing the mapping in terms of finding out the max or mu value of. So from the values of mu A, you can compute the value of mu B. That is what we call as the making generalizing it. So that is the becomes the main function. So this is now better. So that you can see here you can do so mapping can be more, you can find out the composition of those relations, and to composition of that you can find out the max mean operator or and max product operator or product mean operator, etc., etc. All these things can be tried out. There are several kinds of operators for different composition rules, and people have come up with. I'm not going into details of that. You must have already done this. So these are some of the very important things about the fuzzy sets. And then you apply this to fuzzy logic. So fuzzy logic means that is the same mapping and composition which I was talking in terms of fuzzy set. Now you talk about rules or logic. So generally, you have a relation like A implies B, which is called as in expert system, to say that if X is A, suppose the temperature is low. So X is A, so A is a fuzzy value. So low is a fuzzy now variable. So if X is low, so temperature, X is temperature, and Y is, let us say, volume. So, and B is high. So if temperature is low, temperature is low, then the volume is low. So this is one rule. This can be expressed as if X is A, then Y is B. So that is the question. It is not simply that if X is true, then Y is true. In the case of CRISP rule, it will say that without applying the fuzzy rule, it will say that whenever the A is true, then B will be true. So you don't have a membership value. Now we are saying that, okay, A is something like low, then B is low. So you have now, instead of saying true or false, you are saying low, medium, high, etc., etc. And then mapping can be from medium to low, medium to high, etc., etc. So it has given more options. It has given more complexity to be handled. And that is how people, when people start talking about that, X is the fuzzy logic or fuzzy rules only handles the ambiguity or imprecision or something like that. I say, no, this is wrong, completely wrong. The real thing is complex. The real thing is not so simple that you take a threshold and say it is true or false. If you are saying this and saying that I am very precise, but you have applied a threshold which has given a wrong value, there is always possibility that a small decimal number has given a wrong value from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0. Fuzzy logic gives you a method of handling more complex things. And because a language is a complex thing, a single word and a sentence can have many meanings. If not, if one word has only one meaning, then that, because as Chomsky theory says, that because we have infinite meanings and we have finite words. So finite words, how can it be mapped to the infinite meanings? Only if there is one to many mappings. It means that is the capacity of language, the true nature of language, the expression capacity is dependent on how much more meaning it can include. So if one word has many meanings, then the language is more powerful. If the one word has only one meaning, the language is less powerful. And that's why in computer language, which has less meaning, only one meaning to one word, because you cannot have one sentence having many meanings. So therefore, the total things which we can explain, we cannot write an article in computer language. A research paper, I cannot write in a computer language, because it cannot generate the meanings which I want to generate. So to handle complexity, there is no other method of, only the method of fuzzy logic, fuzzy rule. And therefore, to handle the language, the kind of computer language cannot handle it without putting some kind of fuzziness into it. So that is what I wanted to emphasize here. And if you make this as two, so if A, X is almost A, now you are increasing this one, or some X. Now you, what you are doing is that you are putting two fuzziness value. X is A, so A is a fuzzy, so that can become type one fuzzy. Now if I say that X is approximately low, now first of all I was saying low, and then I'm saying approximately low, you can create a new members. But problem is where this, you know, low and high is dependent on, say for example, if the temperature is low, if I say the temperature is low, now go to, let us say Russia. Now in the Russia, the temperature is low means, you know, minus 15 degrees centigrade, you know. The first time I went to Moscow and there was an announcement that today the weather is very good, the temperature is only minus 7 degrees centigrade. And I was saying, what it is saying, the temperature, the environment is good and the weather is good, it is minus 7 degrees centigrade and I will freeze. But they said that, you know, the 2 days back and in December, you are coming here on 7th of December. And the 7th of December, temperature minus 7 degrees is very good. Generally, we go at minus 15 degrees. And if you go to Belarus, my God, I mean, there are 3 feet of ice almost for 3 months. So the temperature is low in Russia and the temperature is low in Allahabad. If the temperature is 15 degrees centigrade today, December night, we say, oh, no, it's bahut thand lag rahi thi, today is low. So see here, the word is, I'm not saying it is said that low, but different people, different circumstances, different country, this low and high can also have different meanings. If you can afford to, you can have a big house. Now, what is you, now who are you now? So what is your income? Will depend. If someone is earning 30,000 per month, and for them, if you can afford, means what? How much price? So dependent on the context of the person, the speaking of the situation we are talking about, of the country, of the society, of the situation, etc., etc. So that brings a new variable. Maybe sometimes explicit, may not be sometimes explicit. So something X is, let us say PQ. Now P is also fuzzy and this is one. Or there is a fuzziness here and there is a fuzziness here. So when you include a fuzziness into fuzziness, now the membership value, which are we, at present we are talking of mu A, mu of mu at the base xi as A. Now this A is not one fuzzy, is not a number, one decimal number, a real number, but it is a fuzzy value. It is still a fuzzy. The value of low is low. So the value itself is also a fuzzy number. Then it becomes a type 2. So that is another extension which we are talking about. So that brings a concept of type N fuzzy sets. So you can talk about, so the membership value of an element is a fuzzy value. That is, it can be something like a it is not a precise number, it is 0.5, it is something like low, high, moderate, etc., etc. So that is, we call this as type 2 fuzzy sets. And therefore, in many of the real life situations, this type 2 fuzzy set is now very much visible. Of course, when you talk about, you know, control systems, and there we talk about very precise values, we can measure the, you know, current, voltage, etc., energy, power, frequency, and so on and so forth. For such places, this kind of fuzziness we may not allow. But it is not a question of what you allow at those places. The question is that, you know, if you just create a simple, in my college days, my teacher always asked to see, can you create let us say, 5-ohm resistor? We said, okay, why not? But say that, you know, it is dependent on temperature. So if today the temperature is 37 degrees centigrade, and tomorrow the temperature is 15 degrees centigrade, do you think the resistance remains 5-ohm? I said, no, sir, it will change. So then how do you design a 5-ohm resistance? So you say, okay, you design at 25 degrees centigrade, this and that, but where is the temperature 25 degrees centigrade? If you put it into a circuit, now there will be heating in the circuit itself and the temperature will change, and therefore this will change. So although we have created something on a particular situation, things are changing. And in the real design, the kind of, you know, the things which are actually used, one of my friends is saying, as the kind of, you know, volume or the diameter of rods we calculate in a beam, actually we put twice the radius of that. Just we say that, okay, for safety, we will put twice of that value. So see here, the twice value has come, which is nowhere in the mathematical design. So such kind of design compensations are always there. So equations, mathematical equations, are developed in a very steady state conditions or a kind of you know, normalized temperature, pressure, etc. So in an ideal state. In reality, there are no ideal state, and therefore for systems to survive, you always give a compensation factor. Our purpose is to define those complex factor itself, so that we don't have to blindly put compensation factor as twice the thing or something like that, or half the thing, something like that. So that is why this concept of type N fuzzy set is very, very important. If anyone has any question, please ask. Otherwise, I will just go a bit about this type 2 fuzzy sets, and then about the CWW, and then our experiment. Anyone?
Dear participant, if you have any questions, please ask to the professor, yes, Tiwari, sir.
Yeah, I will take a 1-minute break, in the sense that you can ask questions.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
No question?
I think they will ask at the end of the session.
Good, please ask. I mean, otherwise I will feel helpless. I will think that you are not understanding. Not understanding, I am not able to convey you. That is how I always think as a teacher. If my students cannot understand, it means it is the weakness of the teacher, not the student. And I cannot have feedback from you directly. So I always say that please ask questions, something like. Anyway, so let us say that something like this, one of the interpretations like this, that is, if this is a general kind of type 2 fuzzy sets as we represent it, as you can see here. So if you change this x on the, you know, x-axis, horizontal axis is x. So the element x has some value. Now its membership value is a kind of strip, as you can see here. It is not a one value. It is a kind of strip. So if you take a particular value, let us say this A, Now, if you go here, so this is the minimum value of membership value, and this is the if you can go here up to this is the maximum value of this one. So from so the value changes from the value C this is A1 to A4. So what is the value? Now what value is not one value, there are two values. At any particular value of x equals to, let us say, A, the value here is okay, it is also written as A, B, something like that. Don't worry. So there are such a value of this is the minimum value and this is the max value. So therefore, we represent this as a type 2 fuzzy set. And the question is that from here to here, the value is, so the value is here C1 and stars and not C1, it is assume A1 to A4. Now, in between this, it can change in a particular manner. So it can change trapezoidal manner. That is, here the value is A1, here the value is A2, and linearly increasing. So it can go on increasing like this. So it becomes, so it has been shown as a bit more black here. And then for this whole strip from here to here, it remains constant. So from here to here, it remains constant. And then from here to here, again, it decreases linearly like this. So here, this we call as the secondary rule. So you have a primary rule like this. So this is the primary rule, primary membership value. And then this is a secondary membership value, which is also changing in a trapezoidal manner. I can make it constant. So here, instead of having a slant, it can be just like, you know, it can be something like this. So at this point, A1, it becomes this much. And then it goes here, and then it just gets down. So that will become a constant value. So within this, instead of only this value constant, you can make it constant from here to here. If this is totally constant, one value, then it is called as the interval type. So because there is no slope, so you have only this limit, A1 and A2. These are the two limits of here and here. So you will get an interval. That's why it is called interval type 2 sets. So we have different types of sets. The primary membership value can be of any type. Let us say this is the kind of exponential rule we have here. We are seeing the graph. So primary is exponential, and the secondary variation can be interval type. So that is called IT, interval type 2 fuzzy sets. Okay. This is the most simpler one. You can have a trapezoidal one, you can have triangular one, you can have here also as a more bell-shaped kind of thing, and so on and so forth. So there you can have various kinds of secondary membership value. So in the type 2 fuzzy set, you have a primary membership value and you have a secondary membership value. Please see that this is not a two-dimensional set. You know, it is not that X is varying this side and Y is varying this side and X has this membership value and Y is this membership value. That is not the factor. You can always combine the two type 1 fuzzy sets. This is not a two-dimensional type 1 fuzzy set. Generally, people do. So one primary membership is there, and primary membership, if you go in more details of that, then there is a variation in the primary membership and you have a range of this. So you always get an interval. So type 2 fuzzy sets will talk about intervals. So between, let us say, A1 to A4. And if it is a constant type, so you know in between them, there the value may be 1 or some other constant. The value will be constant and after that 0. So 0 and then constant value. And then again 0 and then constant value. So you know that. And this range is changing. As you come here, you can see here there is only one point. So the minimum and maximum become same at this point. And as we go ahead, you can see the changes. So as you can go here, and the more number of values are there, I mean, bigger the range is there. So it is not that the interval is not changing in x-axis. Interval can be changing. So at here, the width, as you can see here, it is this much. At here, this width is this much. And different points of time, the width is this much. So now you can talk about in this way. So you can think about there is a outer boundary here. So this outer boundary and there is a inner boundary. And this whole inside between this outer boundary and inner boundary, we call as the footprint of membership value. So we will talk about this footprint of membership value. We will talk about the minima and we will talk about the maximum. So in this minimum and maximum and this minimum and maximum, and think about that both of them at this becomes maximum. So in that sense, the mean of the lower one and the upper one, if they coincide, and generally we assume that they will coincide. So then in that case, you will find out that it is a kind of figure like this. Of course, one can talk about a bit shifted mean. So you can have something like this. So that way it becomes will become more and more complex. So in this case, this interval type two fuzzy sets are very much used, and there are a lot of, now what will happen is that so first of all, there are intra-level uncertainty and there is inter-level uncertainty. So if you are talking of type one fuzzy set, then you have only intra-level, you know, at different x you have the different value, and x can represent different things, different factors. But within that factor, within that one, if you have more inter-level variations, as I told you that, you know, low income is different in US and in India. Similarly, low speed, low temperature, high speed, high temperature, high affordability, etc., etc. All these terms have a contextual thing to be added. So that is inter-level uncertainty that can be handled by type 2. So in this way, again, there is definition. I am not going to into details of all that. So what is now the challenge? The challenge is, if you see that, if you go to that back systems here, let me go here very fast. Yeah, here. This is the system, fuzzy type systems here. Now, when we say that this is a type one fuzzy set systems, so you have fuzzification. So you have a two level of fuzzification, because in this fuzzification, first of all, you divide them into low, high, etc., etc. Now, within that low, you have to again define another variable. So two level of fuzzification will go one inside the other one, that you create. So you will get type two fuzzy set now. And the rule base or the inference system will work in the type two. And then from type two, so these two things, fuzzification at the one level and the second level, can be an additional step. So you have a fuzzification step number one and number two step. And then you have a inference systems in type two. And then you have from type two to type one reduction, first level, and then type one to the value, defuzzification. So main problem becomes this reduction, which we call the type reduction. So while getting the output, apply inference at the type two level. For that, you require a type two rules. So the rule base of this will not be same. And rule base, when I say, of course, it is basically based on how do you do the composition of the mapping, etc., etc. That several operators, max min operator is the most simple ones and very much approximate. These are the two extremes. Generally, what engineering people will do, will just apply max or min operator. No, don't do that. You know, nowadays large number of operators have come, and they have different things, different features. They catch different things. So therefore, apply many other complex operators which are available. But as soon as you apply this type two, first of all, getting this type two rules itself is a bit complexer. Then the next problem is that how to reduce from type two to type one, and then from type one to defuzzification, what we require. So that is the main challenge in the type two fuzzy sets. So in that, now what we were doing is that, but this problem is not there in this computing with words, because this is a perceptual system where what I say is that if you, the human being wants to, you know, this is a system when you want to work on a car engine. So how much amount of, you know, oxygen should come up, or what should be the volume of cylinder? If you want to decide something like this, then you require all those type two to type one reduction. And then from the defuzzification, you get the actual volume of oxygen to be there, or the volume of cylinder. to be calculated. These are the some of the applications, but many of the normal applications which the AI, artificial intelligence, handles does not require such precise numbers. You know? Like if I say that, okay, I want to tour India, and there this is a COVID period, please tell me which are the places to go. Now, this does not require the, you know, exact number, values, this and that. They can suggest some of the values, and they are all approximate values. So that many of the answers to artificial intelligence problems are more approximate rather than all these words have different connotations, you know, imprecise, approximate, subjective, etc., etc. And that has been attached to fuzzy systems. And that is why, you know, very in the initial period, the whole Western logic has, you know, totally denounced fuzzy logic, saying that it is a very subjective factor, things are there. This is not so, this is not correct. As I told you that, you know, the handle the complexity, you require fuzzy logic. So it is not imprecise. It is more precise in that sense, because it is able to handle the complexity. So that is why, but the word has been used, you know, that uncertainty, imprecision, etc., etc. So that's why, but generally what we require is, the way the human being thinks is not in terms of that velocity is this much. You know, car is coming very fast. Let us not, you know, cross the road. Now, what is very fast? If you ask somebody that it is 100 kilometers per hour or 105 or 102 point something, nobody cares about that. So some of the things which are coming up in normal use has to do that. So therefore, our answers are not very appropriate. Therefore, we do not require type reduction directly and that defuzzification. So that's why this concept of CWW came, and it is again given by Jadeh, as you can see here. So Jadeh has written this in triple transactions on circuits and systems, but it is in 99, as you can see here. He has also a book on this. So that's why it says that, okay, it is very simple. You have words as input, you have CWW engines which works in the fuzzy sets and fuzzy rules or fuzzy logic, and then the output is words. So input and output are words. So therefore, many of the details which we are talking about is converting them into type one and then fuzzifying them at first level, then second level, and then type reduction at the first level, and then again defuzzification. Those steps are not needed. It is more like because words are not directly the data. The meaning of the words or the content of the words are data, you know. So the content of the words has to be understood. So what is required is an encoder. This encoding will done may have some numbers or some variables to will be introduced, low, high, approximately, etc., etc., and that will become a interval type 2 fuzzy set. That will go to CWW engine, which can do some kind of inferencing for multitasking, multi-agent, AI agent systems, etc., etc. So that will be going to CWW computing with words engine. That will give an output in interval type 2 fuzzy sets. You can decode that and write a data, either a sentence or data or both, whatever you want. So that is the general framework of CWW. With that, what we did is this very simple explanation. What we have done is we have created, as I told you, that a kind of dialogue system. Dialogue systems is not only fuzzy logic. There are many more things, and because we have developed in Hindi, so a lot of natural language processing has to be done, for which we have developed this one. So first of all, we have developed a data of Hindi dialogues, which was not there. We did not have a model of Hindi language, so we have to create a model of Hindi language, although the model of English is there, and there are tools available for English. We can use some of them, but we have to do some kind of changes, and that paper is there in our IEEE transactions on language and in language learning processing. So that way, so that is one part, creating the Hindi dialogues. But once we created that, we are converting that into a agent systems which can by talking, by through dialogues, we can get information from the user to do a particular task. So these are called as task oriented dialogue. There is another category of dialogues which we call as the open domain dialogue. Now open domain dialogue is very, very difficult. You know, it is something like, you know, you create some drawings of some object, a book or a mouse or a computer, or if you create a painting. So we call this as freehand sketching, something like that. So something like open domain dialogue is something like freehand. I mean, there is no limits to that. You can talk about anything, you know, so like, you know, people discuss in on their corridor, starting from politics to the COVID to their performance in the class. So there is no one kind of logic. So the total amount of general knowledge to be used in such dialogues is huge one. And most difficult task in AI is to get the general knowledge, you know, the common knowledge, the knowledge about the words, which everyone knows, but the putting it into a computer is very difficult. So that's why the open domain becomes very, very difficult and complex process. So what we have done is we're taking a very simple one, and therefore it is called as the task-oriented dialogue systems. The task-oriented dialogue systems has a particular goal to fulfill. So what one has to do is that there will be certain types of things, certain membership values defined. A person will speak to the system. The system will ask some more questions. The person will speak. So there are many slots in which there is no limit on the way one has to speak. So it is not like fill up a form. If you fill up a form, then it becomes very simple, easy. So if you start, okay, what should be the cost exactly? So it will say, okay, this is the cost, not more than 1,000 rupees. It is not like that. The person will speak, okay, I want very low cost restaurant, but good quality, where I can reach in, you know, half an hour, at present only, it should be near about this location. Or first I have to go there, I have to see a doctor, then I have to go there. A doctor may take 1 hour. So I am starting now. Now on this basis, it will try to find out at what time one has to reach there, how much time is there, what are the menu, what kind of, is it a party or just a lunch, or so on and so forth. So the quality of food, the time to reach there, the cost of the food, and et cetera, et cetera. So all these parameters, people will speak in their own way, in their own language, whatever the word it wants. The system has to derive some parameters out of that. So it is expressed as slot value things. So there are slots available. It has to fill up those values into those slots. It has to derive some knowledge to fill up those slots. And those slots will not be filled up by simply word, will be by a range of the values. So therefore it works in the IT2, that is interval type 2 fuzzy sets. So these are the things which we have done. So we have different types of restaurants. So cost restaurant, mall restaurants, normal restaurants, and roadside dhabas. So these are the four types we have taken just for this one. We have variables like cost, time, and food quality, and that it has these are the linguistic variables, very high, low, medium, less high, etc., etc. Quality very good, fair, etc., etc., and so on and so forth. So as you can see here, these are the things which have been there. So we have three variables, and one is increasing, other is decreasing, maybe like this. So all these things are there, and the output will be in terms of very low, little low, medium, little high, extreme, etc., etc. So this is a type 2 kind of this one. So what will be given is a type 2 output, output words, and based on that it will suggest restaurant, that this kind of thing you can get here. So that is what is being done. So the main problem, as I told you, that before I go into details, if anyone has any question, just in half minute, you can ask me. Any question?
Any questions from participants, please ask.
Well, so let me complete this part and then you can ask questions. So, you know, the very important thing which I told you in the very beginning, that applying a type 2 or type 1 fuzzy rule is not very difficult, you know. So there are some systems where you can find it out. But what is difficult is, I mean, what is important and interesting is that fuzzy logic is a method of extension. So suppose there is already a rule, and that rule is valid in the case of, you know, steady state condition. Now the real situation is a bit different than this. So suppose there is a parametric equations available on. So something like y equals 2x raised to power a, and the value of a changes from 1.5 to 1.7. Now this whole range can be there. So we can create the same rule, same mathematical equation. One can now use for this 1.5 to 1.7. And how this varies if we know something like some factors based on that. So it can find out those factors and get those values from there, and therefore it can design the exact equation which will be applicable in that particular situation. So changing those, finding out those factors which varies this raised to power a from 1.4 to 1.7, and for the particular moment try to find out that, okay, what value of parameter a should be there, 1.4 or 1.7 or in between something. This is what is very, very important. So finding out these factors requires certain exploration, requires certain things to be done, requires to see something is there. So change something, explain the things, find out the values, measure at the present, and then you will find out. This total thing cannot be a complete closed set, which is there the problem of, you know, machine learning. Machine learning tries to find out all data, possible data, so that every variation can be encoded. The problem is that all data, where from it is. So it will always say that data bahut kam hai. So data kam hai ka kya matlab hai? Jo experiment abhi hua nahi, uska data kahan se aayega? Aur jo experiment ho gaya hai aur uska result aa gaya hai, to fir where, what is the use of doing that things, experiment? But this does not require that much data. You can expand it heuristically, and you have a mathematical framework for that. So vary the value at some value from 1.4, 1.5, 1.6, 1.7. Okay, it's that from change from 1.4 to 1.5 is too much. Okay, change 1.41, then see again. So you can try at some value, measure the data, and in that sense, I say that creating the whole problem is space. So you can, by half supervised or semi-supervised methods, you can create some representation of the problem space and fill up some of the points which are very distant in that space, maybe at the boundaries. That is what the powerful engine of fuzzy logic is with us. And that's what we said there, you know, the data collection, when we apply fuzzy logic, it becomes so simple. You know, you don't require thousands of data, and from where we will get the thousands of data? So we have some students, around 300-400 students online. We have, you know, had a chat with them, and then we have manually, you know, got all the things recorded, dialogue. And initially there was no system, there was only human being who were answering, and then those things were recorded, and that we created the data collection. One can always say that this is not complete. And therefore, if you give it to a normal machine learning systems, it may not find out many things correctly. But applying this fuzzy set, what we have done is that we have now created rules. And these are the steps which are given in that, you know, this perceptual C framework that is written by, again, the Jade and Mendel. I think let me just see the, show you the reference. Yeah. So, Computing with Words is by Jade. So this is the whole thing. This is the whole framework of conceptual perceptual computing, which has been given and which we have applied, including this which is again by Mendel, this linguistic weighted average, LWA, which we have applied. So our main work is in this applying linguistic weighted average and then finding out this type 2 fuzzy rules for this restaurant problem, and which can be any factor, any problem which has this cost, time and quality factors, food quality factors. So you can have any three factors which can have such kind of value, very low, low, high, etc., etc., and their dependence if they are doing that. So this is just one example, can be applied to solve many of the problems. So what we have done is very simply, we have collected the data, and then because as I told you that IT2FS, what is required is we have said that there it will be of course interval type 2 and it will be Gaussian, and the mean can vary. So mean is not determined, that we fix a mean that this should be the mean. We can change the mean. So that way, what we required is only the two intervals. So the low function interval value and the higher function outside. So inside and outside, these two membership functions, the value where they cross at the zero level, that interval is very, very important. And based on that, because it is a Gaussian function, you can always create the whole function. So that way you can create a value of these functions. So we required interval pruning. So that's what we have done, interval pruning. So when you collect many of the data, some data are, because it is collected from the human being talking together, so some data may be illogical or does not fit into that. So that kind of some smoothing or removal that you require. So we do some pruning, and that is a manual pruning. Then we have created this interval type 2 fuzzy sets, basically the rules and the membership values functions. And once you do that, then of course we are doing the encoding through that kind of so you have to create how to map those rules, how to find out this. And for that, the inference is taking place through by computing this LWA. LWA is linguistic weighted average, and linguistic weighted average is an operator. So the composition rules, as I told you, max, min, sum, product, and there are many such methods, Larson's methods and others. There are many such methods. So for that, we required a, because we required a function, the output is a function, type 2 function, and the type 2 function is a kind of distribution, as you can say, a membership function distribution. So that distribution has to be matched with the range of distributions which is there already available in the rules. So that what the distance finding out we have done by the Jaccard similarity coefficient. So Jaccard similarity coefficient, if you measure between the proposed output and the input given by the user, then you are finding out the exact what output is required at the present moment. So that similarity thing. So what is mainly thing is to find out first computing this linguistic weighted average. And before that, you have to create these rules, and based on that, you compute some area, and the common area, and that so union intersection and union size will give you the Jaccard coefficient, and based on that, you find out the similarity. So that is very the things which we have done. Now there are a lot of details. I am not going into details of that. So these are the cost, time, quality, the range we have taken instead of between 0 and 1. We the interval we have taken for 0 to 10, so that the people, it will become easier for people to rate and give the value. So 300 people have been selected, and age this and so on and so forth. And this is generally a quartile rules as we apply. So when you have a sequence of numbers, statistically you can find out the how much the dispersion is there based on the quartile values. So a first quarter value, you can find out the 0.25 of the quartile, minimum quartile, and then the other quartile is the other side, which is 0.75 of the this values. So that way you can find out, and then this is the range. The difference between the upper quartile and the lower quartile is called as the interquartile range. So that is again a very standard method in statistics. Everyone knows this. So just outlier processing has been done so that we can limit our, the AI and BI, minimum and maximum, the lower limit and the higher limit, upper limit. These two are covered, and this L is basically the range between them. So B minus A is basically the range. So this way you can do some kind of pruning. There are many other pruning methods, and we have selected one. We can select other methods. So a lot of methods, a lot of things have been done on this, how to yearly pruning it. Some people, what they have done is that they have taken a very quick, clean, kind of distribution. So they will try to approximate it with, let us say, exponential distribution. Let us say they may not be exactly symmetric, but one side is some value and other side is some value. So you can create something like this. So as you can see here, if you just create a trapezoidal value, something like this, of course you can create a value like this. So this is the whole range of rules. This is what we call as the IT2FS rules. So this can become like this. If you take Gaussian, Gaussian is also one side when it is decreasing, other side is in intermediate, where in between you can increase and decrease, and other side at the last end it is increasing. So you have initially you have decreasing value, and then you have increasing and decreasing, and then you have a increasing value. That kind of things you can have. This is the primary membership function, and you make a secondary membership function out of that, so you get something like this. So these kind of rules you can get. This is more a kind of manual process. Of course, you can do it automatically. As you can see here, the mean here is shifting. So a mean here is here, and it can go up to here. So that's why we are calling it as uncertain mean. So Gaussian IT2FS with uncertain mean, that we have done. And this is the rule which has come. So as you can see, it is not symmetrical. And it looks like more trapezoidal, because here whenever it becomes more than a particular value, we trim it. But it is not a trapezoidal, it is basically this one. So some of the trapezoidal rules people have created, we have created similar kind of rules with the exponential ones. So these are the criteria and things. And then we come to the last part, which is computing the similarity by first finding out that what should be the output. So you take several outputs, like in the defuzzification process, what you do is that you create a different values and create an area, then find out the centroid or a mean of the area. And that point is taken as the output value. So here what we do is that we create a function, a weighted average function. The weighted average function is simple, that you have some feature or some factor xij, and it has a weight wj. So you multiply them and divide by the add of the weights. So this becomes a weighted average. If they are equal, if there are 9 points, you divide by 1/9 and add all the point values, it becomes. So 1/9 is the equal values. However, there can be weighted values. So the central one can have more values, and as you go on, it is increasing. So when you take a triangular window, and then you weight the factor according to triangular window. So the central position has the highest weight, and then the next smaller one on the left hand side, and similarly on the right hand side. So that you can have a triangular window, you can have some other window, or a Gaussian function. So Gaussian averaging is very much there. So you can calculate weight based on the Gaussian distribution. Here what we are doing is that these weights are calculated based on the membership values. When these weights are interval values instead of one value, then it is called linguistic weighted average. This is a general weighted average. When this WJ becomes an interval, or even the XIJ can become an interval. So when one of them is interval, then it is called linguistic weighted average. That is how the definition has been given. So here, don't think that WJ is a one number, a real number, but it is an interval, and therefore you get a L2 type of functions. So that L2 type of functions, we have a phase rule, we have a rule, IT2FS rules, So into that, take a similar kind of area and find out the distance between them, similarity between them. The things which are matching with that will be called as the output value. So out of the many possible outputs, because there are not all possible outputs are there. We have different functions, you know, low, high, very. We have 7 functions for the output, low, high, very high, etc., etc. So you match that, those rules with the input functions, and based on that, you get the output. So that is what we do. And there are some kind of overlapping because they have been taken from different sources. So, but this is generally Descartes coefficient, as you can know. And Descartes similarity measures are very well known. What you do is basically a intersection, the size of intersection divided by the union size gives you the Descartes similarity measure. And if it is 1 or 100%, that is most similar, and non-similar value will have 0 value. So this way you can compute this one, as you can see here from this one. So for high income person, you can convert this, so it will be something like this, and go like this. So in this way, you can see the different kinds of outputs. For middle income person, you can see the output like this, and for this, you can see the output like this. So there are different outputs for different kinds of person, different kinds of context. So the person which is asking has affordability as low or high or more. Based on that, the system will give different kinds of outputs. That is what the whole system is. So in this way, let me repeat and summarize in 5 minutes, and I will ask you to give some comments and questions, discussion points. So what we have done is very simple. You know, my goal was not to give you the exact equations and other things that you can always find out in literature, and there are many programs also available. But my first point will be there. Apply it in many unconventional areas. You know, you have to do it in control systems also, and do it, but try to explore it in many more ways. Especially if you are interested working in applying words, sentences, and other things, this kind of methods are very, very useful. Machine learning methods, the present day machine learning methods, has to go through a evolution process in which fuzzy logic will be a very important tool. First, of type 1 fuzzy logic or fuzzy rules or fuzzy sets have been explored, has a lot of limitations. So at least one has to go for IT2FS. Our people have already started talking about the 2 levels of learning. And IT2, I mean, the higher level learning or type 2 learning has one of the advantage that, you know, human being directly can intervene. Rather, in fuzzy logic, this is the advantage. Human being at some point can directly intervene into the rules and can create forcibly a rule, and that system will start implementing it. So the knowledge can be transferred directly to the system through manual intervention, and the things can also be created by the system. So you have both the things, human being there to give a feedback, to remove some of the errors which it finds out that this is an error, to introduce some new knowledge, etc., etc. So as we talk about human in the loop for intelligence, you know, don't throw the human knowledge. You take advantage of human knowledge by the system. That is the human in the loop. That kind of things are developing. And IT2, that is, I mean, not only IT, it may not be interval type. Any type 2 fuzzy sets is a very important tool in such cases. Well, we have applied LWA. There are many more methods. Many times I always find out one new operator has come to find out the type 2 similarity, etc., etc. So there are many new things which are coming. You can do that, explore that thing. Output generally is not a number. Output can be simple in the type 2 fuzzy set only. However, if you want to convert it in number, that should not be a great difficulty. You have to apply a method of, you'd have to do it two stages, from type 2 to type 1 type reduction, and then from that type 1 to defuzzify and get the actual values of the parameters or features or whatever you are working in. So that gives you the exact output. And these are some of the references. Many of the things have been taken from there. So I can see that no equations should be considered as mine. Of course, our experiment about the restaurant was ours. And we have collected a lot of data and we have made it public. So you can find it out in IEEE transactions. I think there is one. Yeah, this one, fourth. Fourth, as you can see here, this is a ISCI, this one. The actual data set is there at the IEEE transactions, but this is still in review. In general, it is published in ISCI. So this is the work we have done, and I propose that a lot of other experiments be done on type 2 fuzzy sets. So with that, today let me invite you all about discussion.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful talk. Now I invite all the participants, please ask your relevant questions to the sir. Yes, please.
Thanks.
Okay, so sir, we are getting few questions in chat box.
Yeah.
What is the meaning of interval in type 2 fuzzy controller or type 2 fuzzy?
So as I discussed here, okay, so in this case, as I told you that, you know, type 2 means there is a secondary membership value. That's why it is called type 2. Now the secondary membership value is varying it in this region, you know. In a type 1 fuzzy set, it will be a single, you know, smooth line. It will not be a strip. Now within this strip from here to here, if it is varying as in it is constant, if the value is constant from here to here, the membership value not in this direction, in this direction. So this value is constant, suppose. So this is just rise from here. This is trapezoidal. This is not interval type. This figure is not about interval type. This is a trapezoidal one. If this is a constant, so just make a pulse like this, and then this comes down, then it will be called as the interval type 2. Interval in the sense that the membership value does not vary. It is just an interval. So within that interval, it remains constant. So that is what is called as the interval type 2. This is the simplest one. The next type can be trapezoidal. So we could have talked about trapezoidal type 2 fuzzy sets. It can be, it's a, again a Gaussian. So it can be a Gaussian type 2 fuzzy sets, and so on and so forth. So it is the interval type. The interval represents to the constant value of secondary membership value. Yeah, any other question?
Yes, sir. We have another questions.
Yeah.
We have type 3. What will be the update with respect to type 1 and type 2?
Yeah, that will make it more complex in the sense, you know, it increases the type when the value ultimately will become a number. So the membership value has to become a one real number between 0 and 1. That is the ultimate goal. But at the first level, it is a interval. I mean, it is an interval or trapezoidal. And then it is second level, it is again. So first level, it is fuzzy, and then it will convert to the number. So that is the type 2. Now you think about first level, it is type 2. Second level, I mean, from type 3 to type, the membership value of type 3 is a type 2 membership value. And then type 2 membership value will have a type 1 membership value, and then type 1 membership value will be a real number. So the type is going on increasing, becoming fuzzy. So fuzzy of fuzzy of fuzzy becomes type 3. Fuzzy fuzzy becomes type 2. Simple fuzzy is type 1. So in that way, you can go on increasing. What is more important is, although there are some papers which have given a two-dimensional view of type 2, but that is not correct. You know, it is a type within the type. That is what you should increase. I mean, you should try to understand. It is a kind of embedded variations. So at one level, you can say, okay, this is a variation. You are not seeing it in micro level. But if you want to see it more in micro level, then you can see more variations. Take a small part and again see at macro level, you can see more variations. So that embedding nature is there in type 1, type 2, type 3. It is not a multidimensional, that is, you map two type 1 vectors together and it becomes type 2. It is not like that. Type 1 is within type 2, type 2 is within type 3, and so on and so forth. That embedding nature of these types must be understood.
Any other questions? Please ask.
Your comments also. Give your comments also. I will be very helpful, and it will serve as a feedback, and not so good comment. I will more welcome.
Right, sir. If you have any feedback related to sir, you can also.
Yeah. I mean, including that it is not. Cannot be understood. As I told you, that this will be my weakness. Or what are the things you found interesting and not interesting? Yes, I hope you are.
You can unmute yourself and speak if.
Anupam, are you giving marks to people? Then they will not speak. Please don't do that for teachers.
No, sir. I'm not giving marks to him. My main aim is to, sir, make it.
Make it interesting. Make it more knowledgeable. Let the inquisitiveness, the things should rise. And in India, we have very boring kind of teaching things, etc. So I will say that. Let us be more frank, more wake up, more interesting.